Hi, welcome to the session on costing methods. Today we'll discuss about different methods of costing used by different types of companies. Based on the nature of the business, we use a costing method. We have different costing methods to use to suit different forms of business. Now, the methods what we are going to use manufacturing industries include job order costing, process costing, activity based costing, and life cycle costing. We'll discuss in detail what a job order costing is and which industry it is suitable for, what process costing, activity-based costing, and life cycle costings are, and which industries, which products, which are the purpose of these methods. Job order costing, process costing, activity-based costing, and life cycle costing cater different purposes, give different requirements in different types of industries. A job order costing is also called as specific order costing. Specific order costing means we do not have any ready menu card to cater the customer's product or service or requirement. For that, what we need to do is we need to get the specifications from the customer. Based on that information, we give costing to the customer. That's the reason why it is called as customer specific costing. So wherein we need specifications from the customer, based on which we give a cost information to the client. Like, say for example, you want interiors to be done. So what is the size of the interior to be covered? What material is to be used? Which design we are going to use? What is the time period the task is to be completed? And if the other customer also comes for interior work to be done, so we'll have to still get his specification, that what is the area, which material he wants us to use, and what is the time span we'll have to complete. See here, the cost here is different from the cost to be charged here. So here, customer 1, customer 2. So each and every customer, the costing is different. That's the reason why it is called as specific order costing or a customer specific costing method. Under this method, for each and every task, we prepare a separate cost sheet, which we call it as job. For each and every work, for each and every order, we open a job. Say job 1, 2, 3. To which all the material cost, labor cost, and overhead cost is accumulated. So each job will have a ticket number, a job number, and all the costs like direct material, direct labor, overheads, etc. are to be accumulated. Direct material, we know that what is the material required because it is traceable for a particular product. Direct labor also, we know that how many labor hours are required to complete this task. But this manufacturing overheads are calculated based on direct labor or machine hours. So here, manufacturing overheads depend on direct labor hours. Means we calculate well in advance that what is the manufacturing overhead per direct laborer, for each direct laborer or each machine hour. To have one machine hour work, what is the cost on factory overheads? Or direct labor cost, like 20% of direct labor, or $25 per direct labor hour, or $40 per machine hour. So this is called as absorption. Absorption or application. Absorption. We say that manufacturing overheads are absorbed based on direct labor hours. Manufacturing overheads are absorbed on direct labor cost. Manufacturing overheads are absorbed on machine hours. Absorbed means assumed, calculated, forecasted. Okay. So manufacturing overheads we cannot calculate per job, like factory rent per job. Job can be completed in a day or two, a week, but factory rent, factory building depreciation, equipment depreciation, insurance, etc. We cannot calculate job wise. Therefore, we calculate all the overheads for a particular month divided by either direct labor hours, so that we can calculate manufacturing overhead per direct labor hour, machine hours if our company is a machine intensive, or direct labor dollar cost, so that we can get some percentage. So the overhead is usually charged based on the amount charged on the labor and material. Yeah. So direct labor, direct material amounts are charged. Say for example, manufacturing overhead is 40% of direct labor. So this amount times 40% is going to be applied here. So manufacturing overheads are applied on the basis of direct laborers. So tomorrow, if this applied overhead is more or less than the actual amount, then of course we will have some under applied, over applied overheads that will lead to loss or profit. Now we understand that once we get information from the client, we trace out what direct material is required, say $5,000 for job number 1, 2, 3. This is a serial number of job. Direct labor requires, say for example, 3,000. Based on the past experience, we know that manufacturing overhead is based on direct labor, which is 40%. We assume that 40% of this amount is going to be manufacturing overhead. So the total cost, manufacturing cost or production cost, is going to be $9,200. Then you will add up your profit towards your admin, selling and distribution overheads and all. Then you quote a price, X amount. So what I mean to say is, these amounts are purely based on the specifications given by the client. Now we are talking about manufacturing industries. Some non-manufacturing industry, service oriented, also will use job order costing. Like a web designing company, a legal advisor, a hospital, auditing companies, tourism companies, catering companies, etc. You know, event management companies, they're all service oriented. So still they ask so many specifications from the client before give the costing. So there also we can say those companies use job order costing system. Job order costing system is used for heterogeneous products. Heterogeneous products means the customer requirements are different from customer to customer. Like in event management, the place, the time, the crowd, the equipment required, etc. That depends, you know. Like auditing, the size of the company, the location of the company, the branches they have, the work which is pending with them, the sensitivity of the data. Lots of things need to be considered before you give a quotation that I will charge this much. Yeah. So job order costing, first of all, let us assume that you are working for a manufacturing company. When you buy raw material, you are buying raw material not expecting for a particular customer. So raw materials debit. You have centralized purchase. Cash, if you purchase at cash, otherwise accounts payable. If it is on credit or on account, it is accounts payable. Now, job number 1, 2, 3. Job number 1, 2, 3. So, a portion of this material is going to be used for job number 1, 2, 3. So, we will accumulate job number 1, 2, 3 like job number 1, 2, 3. Debit or work in progress, job 1, 2, 3, debit, credit raw material account. So you will reduce raw material to some extent. What is the material issued to job 1, 2, 3? Likewise, debit wages account, credit wage payable account, wages payable. So this wages will be charged to job 1, 2, 3. So like this, now all the amounts will be accumulated in job number 1, 2, 3. Okay, that's the reason why it is a customer. It is also called as customer driven costing method, and it is suitable for heterogeneous products. Heterogeneous product means customer specification is distinctly different from the others. Like a car is given for servicing, so the requirements are different from the previous customer. House painting, yeah, it's a job order costing, yeah. Anything which has some specification from the customer, we need to apply job order costing. And so you are going to have materials which is as per the records of the company for which the material is used in the job. Labor we can get, and overheads are assumed. Overheads are assumed. Now here, what is the difference between homogeneous and heterogeneous? Heterogeneous product is specifically different. The customer gives an order. Homogeneous means it's a mixture of all will give one single product. Like tea. Tea is a homogeneous product which contains milk, etc., etc., etc. But a specially ordered product that depends upon the costly item, cheap item, quantity, etc., 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 is called heterogeneous product. So when a job costing method is used, you open a job cost record here, right? For materials, what is the material used, on which date, what is it? It is for recording, you know, reference number, quantity, amount, etc. Then labor, what is the job sheet, how many hours are used, what is the price from the labor ticket number. Then drilling, etc., etc., for different works. Then factory overheads, these are not actually incurred, they are applied. Okay, applied or observed. See, material, as per the requisition number, we issued material from centralized procurement department warehouse. From the labor department, we issued some labor hours to this job. These overheads are applied. So applied means assumed, absorbed. Okay. We also call it as absorbed overhead. Now, say for example, we absorbed $5,000 overheads in a job order costing. Now, it is so simple to give a costing that direct material we spent $10,000, direct labor we spent say $5,000, overheads. Manufacturing overheads, we assumed 5,000, total 20,000, where this is a total cost. Then we are expecting a profit from this of 5,000. So this will cover admin, selling and distribution plus profit, everything. So total cost will be 25,000. This is a quote we gave. This is a sale price we gave it to a customer. This one is okay. Direct material, what you assumed, what you are paying, because it's straight to the point. We know the price and all. Labor, we know how many hours are required, what is the rate. But overheads are applied based on direct labor, say for example, absorbed amount. Tomorrow, say for example, actual amount is not 5,000, it is 6,000. Listen carefully. Absorbed amount was 5,000. We charged to the client. We gave quotation for 25,000. Client agreed for 25,000. We provided services. We received 25,000. But after that, we have an analysis saying that absorbed overhead in this job was 5,000, but actual overhead incurred was 6,000. It is called as underabsorption. Underabsorption. Underabsorption of overheads by 1,000. Absorbed overhead is less than actual overhead. It is called underabsorption. It is a loss. And it shows debit balance. Three bullet points. When the overheads are absorbed, the absorbed overheads are then compared with the actual overheads. The difference between absorbed and actual overheads is to be compared to check whether the overheads are underabsorbed or overabsorbed. If the overheads are underabsorbed, it means that the absorbed overheads are less than the actual overheads, and it is a loss because now we cannot go to the customer and say that we want this money back. It's a loss. So this should be charged to our costing profit and loss account. We'll have to bear this loss. It is a loss. Okay. Likewise, say for example, absorbed overhead was 8,000. 8,000 was here. Okay, then it is 23,000, and we charged, say for example, 8,000 profit, so it is going to be 31,000, and customer agreed that 31,000 he paid, but actual overhead is only 6,000. Absorbed overhead is greater than actual overheads. We cannot go and tell the customer that we absorbed $8,000 on your job, but actually incurred only 6,000. We will give you back $2,000. No, it's a job order basis. No, whether profit or loss, we have to bear it. We have to enjoy it, but not to the customer. So this is called profit. If absorbed overhead is greater than actual overhead, it is a profit and it shows credit balance. Obviously, profit shows credit balance, loss shows debit balance. Here we were discussing about under absorption, over absorption of overhead, right? Say for example, now sometimes what happens is we absorbed an amount of absorbed overhead amount is say $300,000, but the actual overhead is $350,000. Okay, so it is under absorbed. Under absorbed amount of how much? 50,000. Under absorbed, no, and it is a loss. Loss. So in this case, it will be transferred to loss only when the goods are sold. Say for example, we have work in progress, finished goods, and also some cost of goods sold. Okay, cost of goods sold, say 1.2 million, finished goods, say 350,000. Say for example, work in progress, 50,000. And this all, you know, include the absorption of overhead. In that case, please do not charge entire underabsorbed overhead of $50,000 to P&L account. Why? Because some finished goods are still with you. Some work in progress is still with you. Therefore, this $50,000 is to be absorbed in the ratio of work in progress, finished goods, and cost of goods sold. What is the ratio here? 50, 350, and 1,200. What is the total here? 1,600. 1,600, 50 plus 350 plus 1. So How much of absorbed amount, under absorbed overhead charged to work in progress equals to $50,000 times 50 over 1,600. Finished goods, we are going to charge $50,000 times 350 over 1,600. Then cost of goods sold, this will go to P&L account because we sold already. Okay. And how much it will be? 50,000 times 1,200 over 1,600. Now, when you calculate these amounts, it should be 50,000 at the end of the day. That should be absorbed. So it is 15,625. And divided by 1,600 times 50. Oh, it is 1,562.5. Then this is 10,937.5. And here 37,500. So the amounts are to be spread like this, 500,000. So your work in progress account would be increased by 1,562.5. Finished goods will increase by 10,937.5. But cost of goods sold, goods are already sold. Therefore, this will be transferred to profit and loss account because this is already sold. This can be adjusted against the inventory. The next customer will bear this.